Okay, welcome everyone. We're so glad that you're here with us this morning. Today we, that is Audrey Lagat, Julius Schlumberger and myself, will take you on an adaptation journey through time. We do this on behalf of and in cooperation with the Ministry of Infrastructure and Water of the Netherlands and Deltares. Before the start, I would like to make some general comments. Please use the Q&A to ask questions regarding the game, and we will try to answer as soon as possible. To take part in the game, we set up a Mentimeter, and you can access it when entering menti.com and the following code, 7716-3778. We ask you a first question about your background to see if the equipment works and the technical system. So please feel free to log in into menti.com and answer the first question. Ah, here we are. So we have some consultants, we have students, researchers, and other. So nice to see that you're all there and that the equipment is working well. I would like to go on now. There are just three comments that we need to give you in advance. We're going to involve you in a thought experiment. It is the first time we're doing this online and on this platform. So I hope you will give us some time in case we are running into a few technical problems. But I want you to invite you, I want to invite you to walk into this version of the future with us. Due to the limited time we have, it's an extreme simplification of reality. But it's mostly about the experience rather than the idea to have a realistic process. This is not possible in the limited time we have. But the goal of this session is that we want you to think about consecutive events and the consequences of measures for the future. Regarding the game mechanics, there are two things to be mentioned. Firstly, this game will be played in multiple rounds, and per round, you as a group will take one decision by means of simple majority, just like the way we did it in the Menti just now. So you will take one decision on what actions we're going to take for a resilient future. If there are any questions so far, please let us know through the Q&A, and we will try to answer them with a written or an oral response. Now, imagine this small river delta. There are some smaller settlements, a lot of agricultural land used for crop farming, and the main characteristic of the delta is its river. Some embankments have been installed to protect settlements and agricultural land against flooding. It is a small and calm river delta where farmers and residents are the two main stakeholders to be considered. News articles from the past give you a rough idea of the natural hazards stakeholders in this delta have to deal with. There have been droughts reported that caused not only very low water levels in the river, but also caused significant yield losses for farmers. Also, despite the existing embankments, floods have occurred in the past, causing significant structural damage and yield losses. For both hazards, time series information is available. And here you can see the evolvement of droughts over the past 20 years. The meaning of the index and the values used is not that relevant. More importantly, it is to understand that the higher the values are, the wetter the considered year has been. Similarly, the lower the value is, the more extreme have been the droughts. You can see that there was a significant drought in 2000, which is the event the newspaper article is referring to. Apart from the drought index time series, river discharge time series information is also available since 1940. It shows the maximum annual discharge. What you can also see in this graph is the crucial discharge, which basically corresponds to the level of installed flood protection. As long as the river discharge does not exceed the critical discharge, so when it doesn't get above the red line, there is no flooding and there's no damage. You can see that in the follow-up of a minor flood and a near flood event end of the 20th century, the critical discharge increased, which basically means that flood protection was increased. You can see that in the current year, so 2021, quite an extreme flood has been experienced in the region. At the same time, knowledge about the future is highly uncertain or even unknown. Knowledge about the future developments of the river discharge, reliability of protection measures, or even more general socio-economic developments are not known, but could have significant influence on the future development of the river delta. For you, these are exciting times because you just graduated from a nearby university and you decided to apply at the local government of the River Delta for a traineeship to start your career as a public servant. You're excited about the responsibility that you will have to shape the future of the region in which you grew up. You want to make sure that the Delta remains a safe and sustainable region in which the needs of the stakeholders are responsibly accounted for. After a week of settling in your traineeship, your supervisor approaches you and asks you to give some advice on a first action that should be implemented in the River Delta. And she provides you with a list of possible actions that you can take. In total, you can choose between 10 actions, 6 to deal with flood risk, 2 to deal with droughts, and 2 other options. Regarding the flood risk, you can decide to raise the levees a bit or a bit more to increase the critical discharge level. At the same time, you know that levees hinder groundwater recharge, which leads to reduced crop yields in dry periods. An alternative flood risk mitigation option is room for the river, where you horizontally move the present embankments away from the river, also allowing for a higher critical discharge. Again, you reduce the risk of structural damages, but at the same time, due to the increased need for space, you have less land that can be used for agricultural purposes, again, leading to a general yield reduction. However, you also gain a benefit for nature, which is benefiting from the nature-based flood mitigation solution. Also, you could decide to engage in upstream negotiations to increase the critical discharge by improved collaborative river management. However, the outcome of this action is highly uncertain. On the level of crops, you could also decide to introduce more flood-resilient crops, which would lead to smaller yield losses in case of flooding, but higher yield losses in dry periods. You could also take the opposite action to improve yields in case of droughts, while accepting higher losses due to floods by means of introducing more drought-resilient crops. Alternatively, you could also optimize the irrigation system to use scarce water resources in dry periods more efficiently, reducing the yield losses in dry periods. You also know that there is always the option to take no action and save the money for a later time. Also, you could take the decision to invest in urban development. This would increase the exposure to flooding. More people, more houses leads to higher damage in case of flooding. But at the same time, it allows to accommodate more people in need of housing. As a trainee at the government, you take your time to understand the advantages and disadvantages of the different actions. At first, you're quite frustrated that you only have a limited amount of actions, which also don't allow for a combination of, let's say, room for the rivers and a raise of the levees. But your supervisor explains you that there is a list of reasons and regulations that only make it possible to take one of the mentioned actions. You have to accept this and you focus then on the differing costs of the various actions. After familiarizing with the possible actions, you take some time to read the newspapers to understand the general atmosphere in the River Delta. 2 articles catch your attention. It seems that the flood that has exceeded the existing protection levels had caused serious impacts on farmers and residents, which suffer still and express the opinion that the government did not do enough to protect them. You also read an article where a recent and popular study suggests that the risk of droughts and floods will increase in the Netherlands and therefore also in your river delta. Based on this information, you take some time, let's say 1 or 2 minutes, to reflect on your options and what action you would suggest your supervisor to take. If you choose for one option, it might not be possible in the second round to choose something else. For example, if you choose raise the levies, you cannot choose room for the river in the next round. Because with a high levy, it is very hard to make space in terms of room for the river afterwards. So each choice has consequences and costs a certain amount of money. If I didn't make you too afraid and you already have an idea of which action you would recommend your supervisor to take, please use the Menti to vote on it. And I'll again tell you the code 7716-3778. So go to menti.com and enter the code and answer the question. Where's my majority? Last chance to vote. Because otherwise we have to choose something. Because as you see, we have... Ah, kijk. So I think we're... Okay, there are still more votes coming in. Okay, I think I'm going to call it to an end. We're choosing a room for the river with a discharge of 13,000 cubic meter per second. Okay. You presented this action as your solution and you felt relieved, but also quite happy that your supervisor agreed with you and took steps to implement this action. In the following weeks of the traineeship, you get many more tasks and you successfully finish your traineeship. Now we make a small jump in time. Now it is 2035 and after the traineeship, you stayed with the government. You got more and more responsibility and you were finally promoted. Now, in 2035, you were asked to review the adaptation actions implemented in 2021 and its effectiveness and decide upon the next possible action. For this, you review charts about the development of droughts and river discharges. Regarding droughts, you see that no significant dry or wet periods occurred since 2021. And you also see that river discharges were rather low in the period. You also use the internal control dashboard to monitor the performance of actions. And you see that from the initial available 10 million euro for adaptation action, you spent already, and Julius is keeping some tension for me, you spent already 3 million euro. So you have 7 million euro left. Because the room for the river action costed you 3 million euro. Let's see, you can also see in the graph of the river discharge that indeed you increased the critical discharge to 13,000 cubic meter per second, because you see that the red line is now a little bit higher, so you can deal with larger discharges. And you can also see in the drought index, that's the graph in the top left, that this was moderate over that period. You stayed well within the boundaries. The yield has gone a little bit down. Well, I'm not exactly sure why that is. That could be, I don't see a reason. Maybe that's because of the drought index, I suppose. And of course, as you can see, you can deduct from the graphs at the left that there is no structural damage. So you are very happy with this review and you find that this is also reflected in newspaper articles. Actually, one article highlights the high trust of the residents that the measures prepared the region well for the coming climate change. You also see an article where a government official reflects on the urgency of new space for housing in the region, given that students cannot find any house to live in and need to stay at the neighboring campsite, and that rents get so high that many people, particularly with a low income, struggle to pay rent, food, and other needs for their families. As a graduated risk manager, you're worried about the situation. Considering the review of your actions from 2021 and the latest news, you again must take a decision. So you take some time, again 1 to 2 minutes, to reflect on your options and what action you would take. If you already have an idea of which action you would take, please use the Menti to vote on it. So again, you go to menti.com and you use the code 7716-3778 and you can vote on your next action. So take into account the whole situation. There's not enough space for people to live. But also know that if you choose for one option, it might be hard to choose for something else in the next round. For example, urban development is going to be harder if you chose room for the river in the first place. But maybe you can do something with floating houses, for example. I see already results coming in. Many people choose for urban development, which is a logical choice, I suppose. Some people choose upstream negotiation. So I think we can safely say that we have a majority for urban development. Not very surprising, I suppose. We're going to travel again forward in time. And now it's 2055 and you have been elected governor 3 years ago. You did very well. And based on the frequent review and monitoring process, you have to look at the adaptation actions implemented in 2021 and 2035 in the lowland river area. For this, you review charts about the development of droughts and river discharges. Regarding droughts, you see that there was one strong drought in 2043. And you also see that river discharges were rather low in the period. And you also use the internal control dashboard to monitor the performance of your actions. And you see that from the initially available 10 million euro for adaptation action, you already spent quite a lot and you only have 3 million euros left. What you can also see is that the regional government apparently reduced your remaining available budget for adaptation action. And you take note of this to ask the regional governor later today during a public event. So most of you chose for urban development. That is an interesting combination with room for the river. Actually, this was not really a scenario that we played out. But also to think a little or reflect a little bit more on the consequences of your actions. If you would, for example, have chosen urban development in combination with raising the levies, you would be in a pretty tight situation. So it's interesting that you first chose room for the river, because now there is enough space for the water. I'm not exactly sure where you put this urban development, because there's also less space to put these people. But if you would have done it with raised levies and urban development in that area, then you would be in a pretty tight situation. So that is interesting. So you see a bit what the consequences of your actions are in this situation. And let me have a look at the graphs to make the results a little bit clear. It is also a risky business that right now, as a result of this drought in 2043, you're actually running into your yield threshold. So you have to be careful that you're not going to get too far under this minimum yield, because otherwise, you don't have enough crop yield. You cannot feed the people in the area. And it's now a bit more crowded because of your urban development. So make sure that you get above this threshold again. Next slide. About the budget cuts. You do not have to wait until the dinner with the regional governor. A brief look into the newspapers provide you with sufficient background to understand why your budget is reduced. The persistent and unchanged financial crisis required budget cuts in many different sectors, including in yours. very frustrating, since now you only have very limited resources to invest in further actions. And with a frown, you also see that media give more attention to climate change deniers that claim that discussions about climate change are nothing but hysteria, as developments in the region show that apart from one major drought, nothing really severe occurred over the course of the past 50 years. Bearing that in mind, you again have to take a decision. You take some time, again 1 or 2 minutes, to reflect on your options and what actions you could still implement. If you already have an idea of which action you would advise, use the Mentee to vote on it. And again, consider the consequences of your measures and think about the costs involved. So remember what we saw also on the yield threshold. I think there are also still a few people who are want to introduce flood-resilient crops. Well, as the future is highly uncertain, this could also be a wise decision. We of course, don't really know yet. But I also see why a lot of people chose to introduce drought-resilient crops, as I really warned you about the drought, the yield threshold. We again make a time jump. And now it's 2075. Your back starts to hurt a bit because you're really getting a little bit older and you're already retired, but you still do some advisory work as an emeritus. At the same time, you also follow closely the career development of your niece, who just started her master's studies in risk management and seems to follow her grandparents' footsteps. Being part of an advisory committee, you are asked to review the effectiveness of adaptation actions in the past and comment on possible other adaptation actions that could be taken. For this, you review charts about the development of droughts and river discharges, and you see that river discharges were higher later in the period. And that you are actually experiencing some flooding. And if, for example, in the beginning you would have chosen for a protection of 15,000 cubic meter per second, then you wouldn't have had wet feet. So that is an interesting consequence of the actions we took earlier. You also use the internal control dashboard to monitor the performance of your actions. Because you all chose almost unanimously for drought-resilient crops, you can actually see that your yield has gone up again and that you're away from this threshold, so people will be very happy with you. Your remaining budget is also still above the threshold, so that's also good. You still have 1 million euro left. And your structural damage logically has gone up a little bit because of these two floodings, but you're not near the threshold yet, so it's acceptable. To make a comment on possible remaining adaptation actions within the limited budget, you have a brief look into the most recent newspapers. And apparently, there's a strong movement of environmentalists demanding for more governmental support regarding biodiversity and enhancing nature. And they request from the government to take appropriate actions. You are relieved since your room for the river actions that you decided upon so many years ago directly contributed to this demand, and it should make environmentalists happy again by pointing out the importance and benefit of this measure that was already taken, even though a bit more room would have been better as you did experience some floodings. Also, you read about the latest climate conference that took place in Marrakesh, where world leaders warned about an exponentially and drastically changing climate in the coming decades. And you are frustrated about this because the remaining actions you can take are very limited due to the remaining budget. Nevertheless, you have recommended a possible action. You take some time again to reflect on your options and what action you would implement. If you already have an idea of which action you would take, please use the Mentee to vote on it. The code is 7716-3778. So here we see the measures. We don't have a majority yet. Who's going to help me to a majority? because otherwise I have to choose myself. Actually, I can already say that Room for the River is not possible anymore because you only have 1 million euro left. So that's also a consequence of earlier choices that we made. Ah, upstream negotiation. I'm very happy. Thank you for this majority. Where are we? This is slide number. Yeah, we make a final jump in time and we're now at the turn of another century. It's 2100. And it's not you acting or reflecting anymore, but your niece, who is now a senior in the government and got the task to reflect on the actions and decisions her grandparent has taken over the course of the century. She sees that there were some more very dry periods and one rather wet period. At the same time, river discharges has seemed to increase generally, with quite some annual peak discharges over the critical discharge. Yeah, you can see the red line, of course, and we were already going over it because our Room for the River option did not facilitate for enough discharge to go through. So even more flooding. And also, if we're looking at the drought index, we see that we're touching upon the thresholds several times. Of course, first with the droughts in the 80s, and now also with the increased flooding, we touch the threshold on the top. And we can actually wonder whether the upstream negotiation did a lot of good. The remaining budget is finished. Your yield is going down a little bit, probably because of the flooding and because your drought resilient crops are not doing too well with very wet conditions. And what is really a very bad case is that you're actually over your structural damage threshold. So what are we going to do about that? How is this game going to end? Let me see. Looking at the dashboard, your niece sees that you managed to keep the budget within the feasible boundaries. So there we're actually down at zero. That is good. But now it is your turn again to reflect on behalf of your niece if you would have taken other decisions in hindsight. And use the Menti for your reflection. And think about the graph that you saw on structural damage and your flooding conditions. So what would you have done differently in hindsight? I see some results coming in. That's really nice. I see 15,000 cubic meter for the river. Yeah, that's a very logical choice. I can see that because we experienced some severe flooding in the end. More room for the river, can be the same. Also increase room for the river to a 15,000 discharge. But then in the end, someone asked for that option, of course, but you couldn't do it anymore because the money was finished. Less urban development. Yeah, that's also a good one because it makes your situation a bit less tight, but then that you still have the problem that you have to facilitate accommodation for people, of course. So where are you going to do that? Flood resilient crops. Yeah, of course we had drought resilient crops, but in the end it turned out that flood resilient crops were also very much needed. And a combination of measures. Yeah, of course, I think we also did have a combination of measures, but as the future is highly uncertain, you do not always know whether this is the right combination of measures, of course. It's a pity that we cannot really have a lively discussion because the chat is not not open to that. So that's a pity. But it's very nice that you come up with all these suggestions for what you could have done differently. And as a good risk manager, Denise also reflects on the experienced uncertainties. And can you help here and give some examples of what uncertainties and surprises you experienced? Yes, economic shock, of course. How could you have known that? You don't know what the effect is of a measure, indeed. You don't know how high the discharges are going to be. or how severe the droughts are going to be. And you don't know about climate change, definitely. Economic situation, yeah, same like economic shock. Climate change effects again, yeah. Population, yeah, and I guess you mean also population growth. Where do people want to live? Demographic changes, exactly. Drought indexes. Yep. Yeah, so you can see actually how big the impact of your choices for certain measures is. Because, yeah, if you choose for room for the river, it's harder to accommodate your people in the space that you have. And if you're doing urban developments outside your levees, that is also very risky. You cannot do that. So you have to think about how are you going to design your space? And do you have enough crop growth to feed your people? So there's a lot of uncertainty in the choices that you make. With these two reflection questions, this serious game came to an end, and I want to use the final minutes of this session to reflect on some key takeaway messages that you might have experienced or could have experienced during this session. One key finding is that the extreme singular events might have misled you to take specific strong actions, leading to a path dependency and lock-in actions, caused by, amongst others, lack of remaining resources. And we got actually lucky that we could still implement all the actions that we wanted, but it could also have turned out differently. And with the actions that we took, of course, we ended with structural damage. Secondly, it hopefully became clear that it is important to understand the multi-hazard context, and with a little knowledge on the local dynamics and the requirements of stakeholders and effectiveness of different actions. And lastly, some of you might already have quite some questions about the climate change pathway that we followed. It is important to keep in mind that we just played one possible pathway in the future. Here in the graphs, you can actually see four different scenarios of how the future could look like. But droughts and river floods could have evolved completely different, as well as leading to very different outcomes of the adaptation actions, as these two plots might actually show. And therefore, it's crucial that in order to analyze the effect of decisions on future development and flexibility, it's important to assess present strategies against a large range of possible scenarios to identify those strategies that are robust or beneficial across many different futures. For this, with these remarks, actually our online game has come to an end. And I hope you really enjoyed our session, and I hope you got some understanding of how it works if you take certain measures, what the consequences are going to be and what the dependencies are if you take these actions. So we actually were inspired in this online game on an article by Marjolein Haasnoot about the thought experiments. And we already have another version of the Sustainable Delta game on which this light version for an online game was based. So we want to give credit to that. And if you think this is interesting, and if you like to collaborate with us in developing this topic and developing this game further, hopefully also to a live version again next time on the road to the GFDRR in Bali, please contact me or my fellow moderator if you want to work with us. Thank you very much.